Welcome everybody to today's coffee chat. I'm here with Dennis, who our CEO at Drug Hunter, and Matt Hess, who is a senior scientific editor here at Drug Hunter. Wrote the last article, so really nice read. I recommend everybody to read it. We're here today to talk about mastering HERG. Off to Dennis to take it from there.
All right.
Perfect.
Okay, awesome. So thanks everybody for joining us on a topic that's very frequently on the minds of medicinal chemists and other folks. Before we get started, for those who haven't been here before, Drug Hunter is Drug Discovery Distilled. It's made by industry scientists, specifically for industry scientists. You know, what we try to help with is finding all this knowledge that's fragmented across so many different sources. There's journals, conferences, patents, databases, news, and endless other sources. And it's really hard to find and apply the scientific insights from all the new disclosures to your work. So we are here to help with that. We distill all of these really interesting nuggets from patents, conference disclosures, first disclosures from other sources and journals, and put it all in one place so that you can search for this information regularly, stay up to date, and learn more about drug discovery. We try to focus on scientific approaches, strategies and tactics, from target rationale to technologies and modalities, to challenges and solutions like dealing with HERG today. What a lot of people don't realize is we actually have a couple structure search functions. You can look up all the approved drugs and molecules of the month database with clinical candidates on Drug Hunter. It's a great way to find examples of unusual functional groups like azetidines or acrylamides. And there's also a keyword search that Dennis will show us a little bit today on finding topics like HERG. So we serve most of the large pharma companies, over almost 200 biotech companies worldwide. I think anybody at all levels from early career to late career find this really helpful for staying current on drug discovery. So if you haven't checked it out, please reach out on drughunter.com. One of the unique things about Drug Hunter is pretty much all of us are former industry professionals. Lou came from Amgen, Alkermes, and Kymera. Dennis and Matt were previously at Novartis, which has a stellar scientific background in dealing with HERG, which they might allude to. And Rory came from Insight, and many of us have spent time in smaller biotechs as well. So today's talk, we'll start with some HERG fundamentals. Matt will go into some common strategies for dealing with HERG, and then Dennis will show us some case studies. All right, so some basics on HERG. HERG is a common anti-target, and you probably already know this if you're here in the audience. In addition to the sodium 1.5 channel and calcium 1.2 channel, they're some of the most common anti-targets that are screened against, because you don't want to hit them as they can lead to the development of arrhythmatic signals like torsade de pont, and that can ultimately lead to life-threatening arrhythmias. Many drugs have been withdrawn from the market for cardiac safety signals or received black box warnings. Many of these have been associated with HERG channel inhibition or the inhibition of related ion channels. And notably, HERG is such a common anti-target because it's so promiscuous. There was a study that showed that in an HTS of 300,000 compounds, actually there was a hit rate of 27% at 10 micromolar. So basically, if you do an HTS, you have a 1 in 4 chance of starting with a HERG signal. HERG is most commonly detected through in vitro screening. There are plenty of assays, and that's probably a whole talk in and of itself on how to detect HERG. People typically start with a cheaper binding assay, then will often further evaluate that HERG affinity or HERG activity in a functional assay like a patch clamp. There are different flavors of patch clamp as well. Then if there is still a signal in patch clamp, people will often move to a phenotypic assay, like in a cardiomyocyte assay or something like that. If there's still a signal, this will often be checked again in an in vivo CV study, such as dog telemetry or rabbit telemetry. One of the big challenges with HERG that I think we'll discuss a bit, probably more in the Q&A section, is there is a lot, it's notorious for having a lot of variability based on assay conditions. Some of these assays are really finicky and difficult to get right. There are a lot of vendors that provide these assays, and sometimes you see variability between vendors. And these assays can get quite expensive. So this is definitely something that medicinal chemists try to avoid relying on screening and instead try to deal with early on, or try to understand how to optimize without having to check every single compound. HERG is often viewed as a canary for other off targets because it's so promiscuous. You know, if you hit HERG, there's a decent probability that you hit other things as well. HERG inhibitors are often lipophilic polyaromatic amines, and those often bring in other things as well. And we'll talk about that in a second. And so if something, you know, quote unquote, looks like a HERG inhibitor, there's a good chance that it hits a bunch of other stuff. So if you can be clean on HERG, that's probably a good thing to strive for because it's a proxy for other things as well. So before there was cryo-EM data available on HERG, there was pretty limited useful structural information. I think people have looked at a lot of compounds with activity and tried to identify pharmacophores to use instead for sort of a ligand-based approach to avoiding HERG activity. Three of the most famous pharmacophores are the Ekins pharmacophore on the top left, the Cavalli pharmacophore in the middle, and Perlstein's pharmacophore on the right. And I believe Bob Perlstein is still at Novartis, right? I think Matt
yes.
and Dennis, you guys are. Cool. So in general, so the what you're looking for is a lipophilic amine. So often you'll see aromatic rings, you know, on one side of the amine coupled with maybe an aromatic ring or a greasy group on the opposite side of the amine. And usually the amine appears in the middle, but you can certainly see HERG activity without amines, or you can see HERG activity without, you know, a substitution on the amine. But generally, you know, if you're looking at a polyaromatic amine, you know, where the amine groups are positioned sort of in these general areas, you know, it's probably good to check for HERG inhibition. In recent years, cryo-EM structures have come out on the full, you know, HERG channel, which has been super helpful and confirmed a lot of, you know, what people already suspected and how this works. So HERG has two states, closed and open. In the open state, drugs can enter a hydrophobic pocket in the middle. And as you can see in panel C on the right, this hydrophobic pocket essentially, you know, looks exactly like it would accommodate these HERG pharmacophores that we talked about. There's, you know, you need a positive charge in the middle, which is where the potassium ion enters that channel. And that's where the amines typically bind. And then it's surrounded by aromatic residues. Hence, you know, if you've got an amine or a positive charge that's surrounded by hydrophobic elements, it's no surprise that those things would fit nicely in this channel. Now, one of the things we can take away from this is, one, you know, this is quite promiscuous. You can imagine there's a lot of things that could have a shape like this with an amine in the middle. As you can see from the structures of various HERG inhibitors on the left, you know, if you got that amine that's positively charged, if it's basic, and you've got these aromatic groups or things like that around it, those can all fit pretty nicely in here. One of the consequences of this is, I would say, a classic rookie error that I have made myself many times, and I wish we had this talk when I first started medicinal chemistry. Probably would have saved my old boss a lot of money and myself a lot of time making compounds that could have been better, is a lot of people try to optimize the amine in the middle. And that can be a mistake because actually, you know, you can see that the middle is quite porous and tolerant of a lot of different substitution patterns. More commonly, if you actually tweak the remote parts of the amine, such as the aromatic groups, making them less lipophilic or things like that, you may find quicker success. So people are often surprised to see that if you put a cyano group, for example, on an aromatic ring far away from the amine, you can have a significant impact on HERG. But I think if you look at it structurally, that helps explain it. And Matt will tell us a little bit more about classic strategies for dealing with HERG.
Thank you, Dennis. Yeah, I think one of the things that really intrigues medicinal chemists about HERG is actually there's a pretty well-defined set of strategies that you can take in order to kind of counter this anti-target. We've all been in projects where we have, you know, a key anti-target that we want to avoid, and you kind of have to work out bit by bit. But because HERG has been such a problem and so many people have worked on it, we have this kind of, you know, repository of approaches that we can take in order to kind of classically avoid HERG. And the first, and really understanding that binding mode is key to understanding why these are effective. So as Dennis said, I think most medicinal chemists' first thought would be if you have that basic amine, And it's key to say as well that, you know, we've gone through the classic pharmacophores, but you can have hERG inhibition without any of these. You can have hERG inhibition with neutral molecules, even with acidic or negatively charged molecules. It's just really these compounds that have this greasy, aromatic, basic nature can be the key ones. So removal or reduction of that basicity is something that you will want to jump on to think about. But I think it's key to think about your on targets as well, right? What is that basic amine doing in your compound in the first place? Is it there to provide a kind of key potency interaction, the key selectivity interaction? Is it solubility? And you might think, okay, which of these approaches are we going to want to take first based on how important is that amine to us? Right. There's lots of ways that you can make a compound soluble, but if it's a key selectivity thing that it's bringing, you might think, okay, we still need that there. I've included a couple of kind of the classic things that medicinal chemists will want to jump on, this kind of medicinal chemist bread and butter for reducing basicity. You may want to think of in inductive effects, you know, include some electronegative atoms in there. So going for something like a pyridine here, you might think of a morpholine, you might think of a pyrazine. And I think Dennis Koster is actually going to show us some case studies later on where this was a really effective approach. Again, if you don't really need that charged nitrogen, you might think of going something where you have a fully neutral nitrogen. So you might want to think of a conjugate effect. So make that nitrogen anilinic. Attach it to maybe a heteroaromatic, or make it into an amide or maybe a sulfonamide. And this will completely remove that charge. Or do you in fact even need that nitrogen there in the first place? You can imagine completely removing and going to a carbon base. Similarly to the fact that, you know, you have this cation pi interaction, which forms that binding pocket. Aromatics will also have a kind of positive interaction with that pocket, with pi-pi stacking, right? So removal of aromaticity is also an approach that you might want to think of. And again, you want to understand what the key features of your compound for your on-target are going to be when you're doing these. Also, the hERG channel is in the transmembrane domain. So some of these will actually be about how can you change the population of the local concentration of your compound, in proximity to hERG. So if you reduce the lipophilicity, or, you know, you go completely the other way and you bring in an acidic center, such as azviserine, if you do still need that basic amine, you're part of how that is effective is you're lowering the concentration in the plasma membrane. And so you will actually lower the affinity once you bind, but also you lower the concentration around it as well. And the other thing that you will see is that sometimes hERG will just disappear by itself as you progress through the SAR. Small changes, which will change the binding within that, within the hERG channel, outside of those kind of key kind of binding interactions. If you bring in steric clashes or change the conformation of a molecule, these can actually really reduce the hERG signal. But these, I think, are a lot more difficult to kind of understand a priori before you actually start getting that data. So Dennis, if you can jump to the next slide. And I think some of the other key things to think about are, when you think about hERG in general in your project, is remember that prevention is better than cure. So Dennis, who brought up that huge hit rate that you see initially, and if hERG is really important to your target product profile, you want to triage really early based on hERG, right? It's always going to be easier to have a compound which is maybe less potent, you can build potency in, rather than having to build hERG out later on in the day. So if you start without hERG, you're going to have a much better time. There's also the question about, you know, what is the safe acceptable level of hERG? Do you need to eliminate it completely? I think historically there was this idea that a 30-fold window between your IC50 of your on target and your Cmax and your predicted Cmax and your PK would be enough. I think nowadays people are much more conservative about this and will want at least a 100-fold window, or even, you know, no activity at 10 micromolar. We recently published an article on Neurix's CBL-B inhibitor NX1607, where they had a 7 micromolar IC50, which is, you know, beyond what a lot of people would think as being safe, but they, based on their modeling and their PK, they decided this is something they're willing to take forward. And remember, you know, potency against your on-target will solve a lot of problems, right? If you lower that IC50, you get a bigger window, but the windows will only get tighter as your project progresses, as you move into IND-enabling studies, you know, that window is going to shrink down. So you want it to be at least 100 probably even more than that. And something Dennis Hu alluded to beforehand, that these strategies are just good practice for lead optimization. Lipophilic basic amines are more prone to promiscuity. You know, they can tend to accumulate in lysosomes. They can lead to phospholipidosis. And, you know, there was a lovely paper that came out in 2017 where they just showed that secondary or tertiary, especially basic amines, will just hit a lot more off targets than neutral compounds. Also, highly aromatic compounds tend to have poorer properties, and lowering your lipophilicity is also likely going to help your clearance as well. So I think, you know, these are just general things you should be thinking about as a medicinal chemist or as a PTL when you kind of define your strategy towards exploring the SAR around your series. And with that, I'm going to pass over to Dennis Coaster, who's going to go through some specific case studies and ways different companies have actually solved these problems.
Awesome. Yeah. Thank you, Matt. Thank you, Dennis, for the nice introduction and the nice setup here. Let me share my screen real quick and make sure that everything is visible. Okay. Matt and Dennis, can you quickly confirm everything's looking good? Perfect. Yes. So yeah, here is this article, which is talking about this cardiotoxicity. So give that one a read as well. But now we want to see some strategies of how we can address HERG. So one of the things that we could do is we can just use our structure search here. And Matt just talked a little bit about piperidines versus piperazines. So let's just explore our molecule database here for some piperazines and see if we can find a case study that really addresses HERG with that. So let's maybe go into this one here. So this is ziritaxestat, and ziritaxestat is an ATX inhibitor for the treatment of idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. Now we can just scroll here, or you can hit Control F to find HERG in the article. And here we find the strategy that the team used at, I think, was it Galapagos, to address this HERG challenge that they had. So yeah, they started off with a piperidine here, as you can see, and by introducing a nitrogen here to make this a piperazine, you can see what effect that had on the pKa. So significantly by two orders of magnitude, lowered the pKa, and that actually solved the HERG problem here for them. So, I mean, now, of course, changing the pKa has a big effect. So, you know, the question is, why is something like this, right? So the pKa, as we already kind of talked about, if you think about the on-rate, right, there's an interaction of the nitrogen, the protonated nitrogen here, maybe with the tyrosine in the pocket, and that determines maybe the K-on-rate of your compound onto the HERG channel. And by reducing that basicity, you're pretty much lowering that K-on-rate to HERG. So this is really an effective strategy here to modulate the pKa of your compound. So let's see if we can find other examples here in maybe our full text search. So it's very easy to search. You can just type in HERG and then pKa, and relevant case studies will come up for you where those problems have been solved. So let's go into this one here from Tango. This is a USP1 inhibitor here. And also the Tango team came across a HERG problem here as well. They started out with this compound that had a HERG inhibition of under 1 micromolar. So that's something certainly you want to address in your lead optimization. So the first thing they did try is to lower that pKa here off, again, also around two orders of magnitude of this guanidinium type structure by, in this case, introducing a trifluoroethyl group here on this core, but that, you know, it mitigated the HERG slightly, but did not really solve the problem entirely. And so they had to combine the two strategies of also reducing that lipophilicity. So you can see this compound here still contains an isopropyl phenyl group, and by introducing this pyrimidine here, this highly substituted pyrimidine, you can lower the lipophilicity of this compound. And both of these strategies in combination then lead to solving the HERG problem. So you can see it's like a tenfold mitigated from the original starting point here. So let's see if we can find some strategies where people have used the C log P to solve problems, where people have used lipophilicity to reduce lipophilicity just as the only strategy. That is also a strategy, and in general, really recommended in a lead optimization campaign. I'll make this a little bigger to overcome a HERG challenge. So there's this beautiful example here from Jnana Therapeutics. They were actually recently acquired by Otsuka, a Japanese pharma company. And this is an inhibitor of kind of a transmembrane protein, an amino acid transporter. And you can see one of the intermediates here, the initial hit, as well as the kind of first optimized hit here, had a HERG inhibition at 10 micromolar of 63%. So now, actually, this is a point that we want to make. This is typically a better way of thinking about your HERG inhibition in terms of percent inhibition at a specific concentration rather than the HERG IC50. So in general, we'd recommend doing that. And as you can see here, this compound is really lipophilic. So by changing this into a urea-type molecule, a urea-type functional group, they were able to significantly reduce the C-log-P. And by that, we're able to mitigate that HERG liability and all the cardiac panels that included the calcium 1.2 channel and the sodium 1.5 channel, they were actually seeing greater than 30 micromolar. So it's definitely clear there.
I mean, it's also important to bring up here as well that, you know, what I mentioned before about lowering lipophilicity will also have other beneficial effects. They also had this CYP3A4 inhibition, which upon lowering that lipophilicity kind of solved that problem as well. Like, this is going to be beneficial in multiple ways for your project, lowering that lipophilicity.
Absolutely. And thanks for bringing that up, Matt. That's a really good point. And also the other thing you said too, it's going to have a good effect on your clearance, and that in this case also had a positive effect on the clearance as well. One more example that I wanted to show is Matt also mentioned the introduction of Switter ions, right? So that is a strategy that I wasn't so familiar with, I have to say. But, one of the most popular type or the most famous case study that came from a Switter ion is actually the story of terfenadin. Terfenadin is a second generation antihistamine inhibitor drug, I should say. And it was approved in 1987, but was withdrawn from the market in 1997, so 10 years later, because it led to cardiac arrhythmias in multiple patients that could be traced back to drug exposure. This was a variable exposure. People were taking other drugs, so it led to like drug-drug interactions. So at that point, the compound was withdrawn from the market. But later, actually, it was found out that the pharmacologically active substance in that was actually the acid, which was an oxidative metabolite, and that didn't have any HERG inhibition. So indicating that, a Switter ion in this particular case works very well. So this is, I guess, one of the most prominent examples for a Switter ion strategy. But the strategy that I want to discuss with you today is the strategy that the team used here to come up with levenkovir. Levenkovir is a very interesting compound. It's a compound that treats HBV and is actually accumulating in the liver and has a very similar mechanism to lenacapavir. It's a capsid assembly modulator. So really very interesting compound mechanistically. But they did have a challenge with that HERG inhibition here, as you can see in this particular scaffold. This is a highly optimized hit here or lead that they had. But unfortunately, it still suffered from HERG inhibition here at under 1 micromolar in the HERG assay. So what they did is they introduced this carboxylic acid here. And you want to be careful with this type of strategy because, if you're introducing a carboxylic acid, that can lead to a few problems, including, membrane permeability could suffer. So also your oral bioavailability could suffer. You could have reactive metabolites as well. Acyl glucuronidates are, notoriously famous for liver tox. So what they did here, they were very mindful about the strategy. They introduced like a sterically hindered group here, a sterically hindered acid here. And that really, for them, solved the problem. Yeah, and I guess with that, that were some of the case studies I wanted to discuss. And with that, I think let's open the forum for a discussion.
All right, thank you, guys. And real quick, can you hear me okay? I saw in the chat there were some concerns about my mic in particular. Dennis and Matt?
I can hear you okay. Matt, how about you?
Yeah, I can hear you fine.
Okay, all right. Well, if anybody else in the audience has any issues, let us know. All right, so I think, I know, Dennis, there were a couple questions that were submitted in the registrations. I think there are two live questions here. Maybe the first one, just in reverse order, is can you elaborate a bit more on why percentage inhibition might be better than full IC50 against hERG, thinking of some common project TPP requirements? I think they're referring to what you were saying, Dennis, about the percent inhibition on the one case study.
Yeah, I think it just gives you a better understanding. Matt already alluded to it. You want to think about your hERG as kind of in a relationship to the free Cmax that you're getting at the therapeutically effective concentration. And the percent inhibition is also related to kind of the, I guess, possibility of a cardiac arrhythmia event. So in general, it's recommended, I found this in the Bob Perlstein paper, that the inhibition is better measured as a percent at a certain concentration, because it really gives you a better idea of where you add in relation to your Cmax, free Cmax, I should say.
Yeah,
and it should be said that, you can have kind of bad outcomes in terms of cardiac toxicity is based on a low level of inhibition as well. So like if you have 50% inhibition, that's going to be really bad for the patient. So I think understanding what the percentage inhibition is at a relevant concentration is going to be the best way to think about that.
Yeah, it's a couple practical considerations. It's cheaper as well, often in screening cascades, to measure a single point rather than get a full curve. Obviously, people do measure IC10, IC20, IC50 for hERG, but usually, to Dennis and Matt's points, if you're getting the 50% inhibition, that's probably quite bad. When you think about hERG, one of the reasons it's so challenging as an anti-target is you don't need to cover hERG very long, right? Heartbeats are a couple seconds. So your target coverage needed for that anti-target is not long. Whereas for your intended target, you probably need to cover it with C trough, right? So you're comparing Cmax on a low residence or on a low residence time requirement target to C trough of your intended target. That's probably a longer discussion, but hopefully that's helpful. Okay, Dietmar Weitz asks, did I understand right that the inhibitor might reach the binding site in hERG also via the membrane compartment? I think that might be referring to, Matt, your comment about the Zwitterions, why Zwitterions work.
Yeah, so I don't think there are multiple other binding sites apart from kind of that main one in the pore. But I think it's less that it's able to access the pore through the transmembrane. But if you have a higher concentration, which is in the membrane where the opening is at the membrane surface, right? So if you have a higher concentration in the local environment, then it's probably going to be more what I was alluding to there. Yeah. I don't believe that you can access the pore through kind of the protein.
Yeah, I think this probably also opens a broader discussion on why are lipophilic compounds more promiscuous. We do have a good article on this on Drug Hunter called Why Does Log D Matter or something like that. But if you search Log D, there's good discussion about that. There are, and to your point, I think there are some allosteric hERG inhibitors that have been reported, but it's less common. But yeah, I think Matt was speaking more in general on, why lipophilic compounds tend to be more promiscuous for a number of reasons.
Yeah. Also, I think one thing while we're talking about, binding modes and different mechanisms, I think one thing that I did want to bring up is the trappability of a a hERG inhibitor is actually pretty important, and it can be structurally modulated. So it's a very, very interesting topic. So there's basically a difference between a trappable inhibitor, which remains bound to the hERG channel when it closes, actually, and gets trapped inside that channel, and actually then accumulates and can lead, you know, like by with this accumulation, if you then get to like, you know, occupancy of like, you know, let's say 20%, you can have very much a higher risk for arrhythmia. Whereas when you have a non-trappable inhibitor, which, you know, gets expelled when the hERG channel closes, that doesn't accumulate and has maybe a lower risk of safety. So Bob Perlstein advocates for differentiating those early, and you can differentiate those types of trappable versus non-trappable inhibitors actually via a normal assay, a normal hERG assay. One actually is voltage dependent versus the other one is non-voltage dependent. So they're easily differentiated. And there are actually structural modifications that you can do in collaboration with your computational chemist to then understand versus if something's trappable versus non-trappable. So there are really minor distinct structural modifications that can lead you from a trappable inhibitor to a non-trappable inhibitor, which is where you want to be if you have an inhibitor to begin with.
There's nice kind of analog between that and CYP inhibition, right? You have reversible CYP inhibition and you have time-dependent CYP inhibition, and one is much more of a problem, right, in a project than the other.
Yes.
Yeah. And I think we should chime in and note that we will be following up this talk with possibly more than one article on hERG in particular, because I think we had 20 minutes to give a short hERG 101. I think 201 and 301, you know, will be covered more on Drug Hunter and are present in some of these case studies that we showed. All right, thank you. Another question is, how do zwitter ions behave in terms of permeability? I can take that real quick. I think oftentimes when people look at zwitter ions, they're surprised that many of them can be orally bioavailable or cell penetrant. And part of that is, you know, there's two states, right? There's the charged state and then the neutral state. And actually, the oftentimes for permeability, it's the neutral state that can actually be quite permeable. So it's pretty unexpected. I've personally seen some very, very permeable zwitter ions in the past, and there are plenty of approved drugs that are zwitter ions, which is pretty interesting, even without active transport.
And then maybe one more. Sorry.
Oh, yeah. Go ahead, Dennis. Or Matt. Sorry.
It should be noted that the terphenidine drug that you brought up, one of the reasons it was so successful before it was withdrawn was because it was because the active metabolite was the acid. It was seen, it was a non-CNS accessing drug, so it was actually the first non-sedating antihistamine. So there can be deleterious effects by having a zwitter ion, but I think really there's also an interesting thing which Kurt Ritter in the questions brought up, that actually if you try and keep the pKa of the acid and the base within a certain distance of each other, you're more likely to access that neutral species, and so you're more likely to have much better permeability.
Yeah, I was actually going to bring up that Werner article that we have on this exact topic with non-classical zwitter ions, where Novartis was basically trying to solve this exact problem in the beyond rule of five space. So as a teaser, I'll put that in. Read more about this on the HRO761, I think, article, the Werner helicase inhibitor from Novartis. Very interesting topic.
Awesome. So let's see, are there any programs for determining if a specific compound possesses a risk for hERG inhibition, taking into consideration the compound's structural features? I wonder, maybe that gets to actually one of the pre-submitted questions, Dennis, about you know, computational tools or things like that for screening hERG.
Yeah, we had a
question. I don't know
question.
If you want to pull one of those questions up.
Yeah, the question was that we had submitted before was relating to hERG. There are a lot of computational tools, AI suites, and other tech all claim to be best. How much do we need these with our current medchem understanding of hERG? That was the question.
I think that's a loaded question. That's going to get a lot of different answers depending on who you talk to. I don't know, maybe Matt or Dennis, do you want to chime in?
I think
behind.
prediction is one thing, but you know, medicinal chemistry is the last great empirical science. You have to, this is not a theoretical pursuit we're doing here, right? It's a practical one. At the end of the day, it's going to be data that's going to kind of define how you go forward. I think some of these can be useful in terms of, you know, triaging a set. If you're going to screen, say, okay, if HERG is important, how can we triage to kind of remove some classic HERG pharmacophores? But really, if it's something that you really are interested in your project, you have to run the experiments, right?
Yeah, I think personally, you know, just an opinion is, I think where these sorts of computational tools are helpful is for triaging large sets of molecules. So for example, if you do an HTS or a focuset and you get thousands of hits or hundreds of, you know, tens of thousands of hits or something like that, or a virtual screen or even a DEL, right? Or, well, maybe not DEL, but you have a bunch of these hits that no human being can physically go through and guess if they're a HERG inhibitor or not, then yes, absolutely, these software tools are invaluable because there's just no way a human being can do that. But once you get to, you know, lead op stage at that point, you know, I'd argue it's probably best to make sure all of your team members are reading Drug Hunter and using best practices for design. But beyond that, I think, you know, you probably get more bang for your buck by understanding best examples and doing the screening or doing the evaluation.
Yeah, I mean, maybe a quick comment there is, in order to use all those AI tools and machine learning tools and whatnot, you need first a good set of data. As we've already talked about, it can be difficult to obtain high quality data for a HERG assay. So in order to like power all these predictions, you want to make sure that you have reliable data in an assay that is working well. So you need to collect those data points in order to like get really anything useful out of that. And then what I would say, I personally have tried to use QSAR models for HERG. Usability of those is debatable since HERG, as we saw, is a very promiscuous target. So I would say being aware of those strategies that we discussed is definitely the first thing, so that you can really make the smartest decision as of which compound you want to make that brings your project to the next level, I would say.
Yeah, and just to expand on that point, I mean, there is kind of an almost inverse correlation between what makes data, you know, powerful and biologically relevant versus what makes good data machine learning, right? So, you know, you can think of maybe HERG binding or patch clamp might be kind of much better to be able to interpret for machine learning, but it's less relevant. And then as you go to more biologically complex systems, the data is going to get much messier and you're going to have a lot less of it because it's so expensive to run these. So it's, I mean, you can train a machine learning kind of tool on this, but as with all tools, you just need to be aware of what it's useful for and what it's not.
Yeah, I think that gets to another set of questions. I think several questions get to this, which is about the HERG assays. So, you know, when should you use patch clamp versus going with the binding assay, and how do people typically approach this? And I think that might have been one of the pre-submitted questions as well, Dennis.
Yeah, I mean the kind of the HERG binding, I mean it's typical when you think of a workflow, right, that you want to be able to have, you know, quick and cheap at the top where you can really kind of have a high throughput to really triage quickly. And you know, the binding can be really quick at that and can tell you kind of quite a lot of data quite quickly. But you know, these things, there was actually a question that came up. There are some things which actually don't directly bind to inhibit HERG, but can nevertheless change HERG activity through changing the trafficking of HERG, right, to the membrane. Also, if you think about patch clamp, which is kind of the next level of sophistication, which is going to be more expensive and less throughput, you know, this does have downsides as well. Highly lipophilic molecules, which we know are issues for HERG, can stick to the plates. They can disappear into membranes, and you can end up with kind of a lower real concentration in your assay well than you think you can. So you can get false negatives that way. You know, I think you want to be able to put things through multiple orthogonal assays, you know, so have a binding assay, have a functional readout assay to be able to kind of differentiate a true kind of negative from a false negative or a positive, right?
Yeah, and I think this gets to a broader discussion, maybe at a higher level, which is also I'm seeing as a thread in the questions. It's, you know, how large of a window, you know, is recommended for HERG? 30-fold, 100-fold, you know, how do you measure it? Do you use IC20, IC10? What's the unbound Cmax to HERG IC50 ratio, et cetera? So I think maybe a better way to think about that is why you want such a window, right? And I think we alluded to this before where, you know, you're talking about, you know, target, you know, you don't need to hit HERG very long, right? So, you know, HERG inhibition in the initial phase of your drug absorption, when the concentration is highest of your drug, that Cmax, and if you think about the PK curve looking like this, you've got to target your cover at your, you've got to hit your target at this stage, often at trough, but you're hitting potentially HERG at Cmax. Now, the other issue is when you're going into humans, there's PK variability in humans as well. So, you know, in 10 patients, right, your Cmax might be here, but what if you've got one person out of 100 that's got a mutation or whatever that drives your drug concentration way up? They don't have a CYP isoform or something like that. So those are the things that you're not going to see until you've got 100 patients in it. You know, so there
windows only get smaller, right?
And yeah, the window only, exactly. The window only gets smaller the more people you test this in. So, you know, in oncology or in a severe indication where the risk is more acceptable, like, okay, maybe 30-fold would be tolerated because, you know, people are in the hospital anyway, you know, monitoring might not be, you know, so bad. But if you have an issue where the FDA thinks that you need to have patients be monitored, then that automatically rules out your drug for just practically, you know, no patient with asthma or pain or whatever is going to go into the hospital and take your drug, you know, while wearing a monitoring apparatus. So, you know, I think, you know, whether it's 30-fold or 100-fold is probably splitting hairs. I think it's more, you know, thinking about what's going to be useful for patients and physicians, you know, how much of a risk is this for the people that you're trying to treat? And I think nowadays, I think outside of oncology, it's a different organizations are differently conservative, but some organizations will say no signal at 10 micromolar period. Others will say, you know, over 300 even. So depends on the setting.
And as a PTL, defining this kind of, you know, the target product profile for your team or as a medicinal chemist, when you're thinking about making analogs, you know, talk to your ADME rep, talk to your toxicologist, right? Really kind of make sure everyone knows what the type of the, you know, desired profile is, and that's going to differ based on your indication and on your kind of route of administration.
Yeah, definitely in like more chronic indications, let's say it's really difficult to tolerate something like that. We saw like idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, right? You need to get rid of that HERG signal. It's a chronic indication. HBV, chronic indication, right? There actually, one of the advantages of that acid was also that the acid was more enriched, I should say, in the liver. So it's something that's really kind of tissue selective. It's for HBV, it's great, right? For toxicity, not so great. But for HBV, but where the virus is in the liver, that is great. And maybe your compound doesn't get too much to the cardiac tissue, right? So that's often a case. And I think Matt really nicely highlighted this in the recent article on the AbbVie compound, the MCL1 inhibitor, that if you're more selective in the tissue that you're looking at, or if you're kind of staying away from the cardiac tissue, which is what some of the new ADCs are doing, you're going to be a little safer. For things like oncology indications, where you can monitor patients, that's, of course, a different discussion. And even for certain antibiotics, where this is a life-threatening disease, it can be a different discussion. But, you know, of course, actually a lot of some of the antibiotics, I should say, are given in really high dosages, right? So, of course, the dose is always going to be a risk because your Cmax is going to be way higher at higher doses, understandably, right? So you always want to kind of look at the context, what kind of dose you need to be giving to your patients. So optimizing for a low dose compound is the best thing you can do early on in your lead optimization program.
There was an interesting question I saw there about species and species difference. And I think it's important to bring something up that the rat QT is not affected by hERG in the same way that it is for other mammals. So you cannot use rat as a preclinical tox species to investigate the effect of hERG. This is why you need to do something like if you're doing an ex vivo experiment, it's typically on rabbit hearts rather than rats.
I can't remember. I think it was guinea pigs were pretty common, right? Before dog, guinea pigs and rabbits, cute little guinea pigs, poor guinea pigs. all right. So let's see here. Oh, and as far as species, yes, differences. That's definitely a big one. I think in vitro, I don't know if you guys have seen this. I haven't seen too much variability in vitro between inhibition and in the different different animals. Not like, you know, tenfold or greater. Have you guys seen that before? I'm sure this is probably an ask the audience thing. I'm sure among the hundreds of companies that are represented here, somebody's probably seen something crazy.
I mean, I think the in vitro ones, you just go with human, right? It's just recombinant hERG into kind of the cells that it's done in. And then you just look for any kind of, I guess, phenotypic readouts or for cardiac effects, either kind of, in telemetry, to telemetrize dogs, is actually a functional effect of this or not. And that maybe gets to one of the questions was asked about, can you elaborate a bit more on the FDA requirements for hERG selectivity? And actually, we were discussing this. I think dog telemetry studies are typically required by the FDA for an IND, right? So it's, I'm not sure if they typically ask for the actual, biochemical inhibition, but they want to see that functionally there is not a cardiac effect of this.
Yeah, I don't know if it's explicitly required, but I think it's just best practice. I mean, as far as I know, almost every clinical protocol I've looked at recently has had that in the supporting information. So I don't know, but we probably need a regulatory affairs person to give you a definitive answer, but it's something I think you'd probably assume you are going to do before, yeah.
Especially if you've seen a signal in your preclinical studies, right, before that. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think maybe one other topic that we also had a question about prior is CNS, and I'm seeing this here in the questions as well. So the question that was submitted before was, I would like to understand more on the trade-off design principles of CNS drugs. When reducing the pKa of the amine, as well as the lipophilicity, how can we target molecules still going into the brain? Do you guys want to comment on that, or?
No, no,
you're
please.
The one that wrote the brain article, Dennis.
It's true. Yeah. So I would say, like those are certainly, as Matt alluded to, reducing your basis, the pKa, and reducing lipophilicity are certainly in general good to overcome challenges. I mean, lipophilic amines don't only have hERG problems. They also have lysosomal trapping, as Matt mentioned, where you can have phospholipidosis. You can typically have high clearance. They may help with solubility, but what you should be paying attention to really is, I guess, surprisingly, you can have KPU use where you balance the compound, where you, for example, have intramolecular hydrogen bonding. So you can actually have really polar beyond rule of five compounds that are still going into the brain. So you don't need the lipophilicity to drive a compound into the brain. That has been now shown multiple times, and I'm always perplexed when I see, and that's, I guess, another question in the chat, about in these PROTACs that are still brain penetrant, right? Question is if you can invoke things like the chameleonicity of those compounds so that they can kind of fold on themselves and still be permeable with those functional groups. If you have hydrogen bond donors in your molecule, if you can mask them, I think that would be helpful. So there are a number of different strategies that you can use where you move away from lipophilic basic amines into like a more, I would say acceptable chemical space where you can still have good brain penetration and stay off target from hERG. But would love to hear your guys' comments.
Yeah. I think that does get to one of the points that's often understated about HERG. It's, you know, oftentimes the reason it's hard to deal with is it's easy to say, oh, add a zwitterion or reduce the pKa, but sometimes you need, you know, basic amine for potency, or you need, or you just can't tolerate a zwitterion. So I think that's where these small changes, like doing nitrogen walks, you know, introducing small polar groups in different regions, you know, of the molecule, things like that, changing the orientation of your molecule, like how the amine is actually linked to the rest of the molecule. There's a really good case study. I remember a Blueprint, I think, in one of their programs, FGFR4. I think Blueprint had an FGFR4 program where they had a amine dangling off of an aromatic core, and they just could not get rid of this HERG signal. So what they ultimately did was they basically did a cut and paste. They moved the amine from one part and hooked it up to a different part of the molecule, and that completely got rid of HERG. Difficult to do, but you know, is a nice approach. On a practical note, I see somebody's asked a few times, is there a fee to use the different search functions on Drug Hunter? I guess we should have prefaced this with, yes, these are everything you saw, the case studies, the search, the structure search, these are members features. We do support almost 200 companies, and I see quite a few people in the audience that are at member companies. So if you're interested in using those, definitely submit an information request on drughunter.com, and one of our team members will try to help you get set up through your institution. So I like the brain. Oh, there was another question from Domen Kampjut on, you mentioned NAV1.5 and calcium 1.2 at the beginning. Do strategies that minimize HERG binding also help with activity against these other off-target channels? Short answer is yes. But Dennis and Matt, I don't know if you want to elaborate further.
Yeah, I have to admit, I haven't worked specifically on those kind of targets, but it is certainly possible to be able to differentiate between these different kind of ion targets. And I think it's one of those things that, again, it's, you're going to want to try and work out the SAR within your series, right? So you're going to be wanting to screen against these and say, okay, within these series, does removing this basic amine help? I mean, obviously, these all are conducting desulfated ions, so lipophilicity is kind of going to be a strong feature, which is going to be encouraging the binding of this into that pore. So I think that's something that is almost certainly going to cross over between them. But having that specific in terms of the pharmacophore shape, I'm not sure I can comment on that.
I'd say similar things. I mean, they're set up a little differently. The pore size is certainly different. Sorry, they channel different ions, certainly. And yeah, in general, the currents are a little different, of course. So it is a very important question. If you're, for example, working on a NAF 1.7, NAF 1.8 program, you, of course, want to make sure that you have your SAR against NAF 1.5. And some of those structures can look somewhat different from classical HERG pharmacophores, I would say. Just if you think about tetrodotoxine, which is the classical NAF 1.5 inhibitor, it looks not like a HERG pharmacophore, really polar. But yeah, in general, I think those strategies should help. We should follow this up with an article on Drug Hunter as well.
It's coming. Yeah. So I know we only have about 5 minutes left, and there are still about 20 questions. So unfortunately, we won't be able to get to everybody, but we will try to answer more of these in follow-up articles. I did see one earlier question from Ivan Jewett on, do you typically collect HERG data on major metabolites as well, and at what stage? So short answer there is, I think when we talk about phenotypic, you know, in vivo studies, I think often, you know, and you guys can chime in as well, you know, you probably do the phenotypic, you know, studies first, or like, you know, the guinea pig model or something like that. And then if you see a signal and you can't explain it by your parent compound, then you might look at metabolites and you know, look at it that way. Or vice versa, if you have a major metabolite, like that's huge, a high concentration, you might check that in vitro just to be safe. I think probably at that stage, you know, you're focused on the in vivo data. But Matt, Dennis, you have any?
Yeah, I mean, typically as part of the IND process, you're going to want to start profiling the major metabolites. And I think, you know, a good thing to understand about medicinal chemistry is you only find what you're looking for. So if you do, again, if cardiac is going to be a real issue for your program, you're probably going to start looking for these things earlier on. You're going to start profiling metabolites. But obviously, it's going to be a cost-benefit analysis. You know, net ID, synthesizing these things and then testing them, it's not cheap, right? So I think if it's really important to your program, then it's something you should move up your kind of workflow to an earlier stage. But typically, I've been in projects where they only start looking at metabolites once you've already picked your candidate and you've already kind of, you know, booked in your clinical trial slots, right? So,
I mean, one thing that I'll add, those are all great points. One thing that I'll add is the risk of the metabolite having a HERG problem should technically be lower, since oftentimes it's oxidative metabolism. So you oftentimes have more polar compounds that come out of your metabolism. So for example, with the terphenidine, as we saw, that, you know, solved the HERG problem of the parent. All the other things should be considered, but in general, the probability of your metabolite being a HERG should be lower if it's mainly oxidative metabolism.
Mm-hmm. All right, so 2 minutes left. Dennis, do you want to pick a last question or one of the pre-submitted ones?
I guess I'll have you pick. Sorry, I didn't really.
No worries. No worries. I guess maybe instead of questions, I can read two comments here that I liked. Oh no, it disappeared. I thought I had seen it. Okay, so I think Kurt Ritter says a good strategy is to look for zwitterions with a difference of pKa of acid and base of less than 3. Wisdom from Lipinski. One has a certain concentration of a neutral permeable form versus the true zwitterion. Yeah, so looking at the differences between the pKa of the acid and base is definitely a tactic in designing zwitterions. And also a good example to look at is AstraZeneca's PARP1 selective inhibitor. They solved HERG by reducing lipophilicity and getting also a brain penetrant inhibitor by masking the amide with a fluorine close by to the H-bond donor. Okay, so yeah, I think the rest of the questions, it's going to just take too long to answer. So I think, yes, we'll aim to answer these in a follow-up article. Thank you everybody for all the engagement, joining us live. It's always a lot of fun to be here with you. Thank you for making time this morning and hope you enjoyed this.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
Thank you, everyone.
All right.
Bye-bye.
All right. Take care, everybody.